Australia's biggest vaccine bet looks to have paid off, with the Oxford AstraZeneca jab showing to be 90% effective against the killer virus. Health Minister Greg Hunt says millions of doses made in Melbourne are now on track to be rolled out in March next year. Professor Katie Ewer is a researcher from the University of Oxford and she joins us now from the UK. Professor, this is what we've all been waiting for. You must be delighted.
Good evening. Yes, it's a very exciting day for all of us here in Oxford.
Katie, we've just been talking this morning about the level of protection we get from this vaccine. It's showing up to 90%, but that's only if taken a certain way. Can you explain that to us?
So most of the volunteers in our clinical trial received two doses at the full dose, and that gave an efficacy of around 70%. But what was really interesting in a subgroup that we vaccinated was that if we gave them a half a dose followed by a full dose, we seemed to get 90% protection, which was not a result that we were expecting, but it's really intriguing and it's very good news for the vaccine because it means the doses that we do have will be able to go a little bit further.
I mean, isn't this amazing that a month ago we were worried that we weren't even going to see a vaccine, and then if we did, we were thinking that 50% effectiveness was going to be a great result?
Yes, absolutely. I think we're all really pleased and delighted with just how well these vaccines have shown efficacy. At the start of this process, we didn't even know whether it was going to be possible to have one effective vaccine. So to have three is a massive breakthrough for science, I think.
It's not as successful as the ones from Moderna and Pfizer, which are at about 95% effectiveness. However, it is going to be cheaper and easier to store, correct?
That's correct. And I think at the moment, you know, given that we need so many doses of this vaccine to deploy, it's important to use whatever vaccines we do have available. So I think as we go on to follow up these vaccines, the differences between 90 and 95% may vary a little bit, but these are all very high efficacy vaccines and they all have the potential to have a massive impact on this pandemic.
How soon until it's given approval here in Australia and who should get it first?
Well, that's a very good question. I mean, in the UK, that decision is made by the UK regulator. And I think it'll be the same in Australia, where you have your own regulatory authority who will go through the same safety data as every other country and decide whether it's safe and suitable for use in Australia. The question as to who gets it first is really a question for government. Here in the UK, the government have decided that it should be prioritised for people working on the front line of the healthcare services and also for those people in care homes, but that may be different in different countries.
Do you know yet if it's safe for children?
We haven't tested this vaccine yet in children. It's something that we have planned to do, but because the disease mostly affects older adults and those with pre-existing healthcare conditions, we really focused our clinical trials on assessing the efficacy and safety in those age groups first. I think there is still a plan to look at safety and efficacy in children, but that will come further down the road because they are much less at risk.
So do you think this idea of a March rollout next year here in Australia sounds viable?
Yes, I do. We've always planned to have large numbers of doses available globally for this vaccine with equitable access for everybody. So I think with the plan that we have for vaccine development and manufacture with AstraZeneca, it should be possible to have hundreds of millions of doses available.
We love hearing that. Professor, thank you so much for joining us this morning. We appreciate it. Carl.
That's amazing, isn't it? A vaccine by March, folks. Well, back home now, New South Wales has officially met Queensland's 28-day threshold for no unlinked community cases, but the Sunshine State remains firmly shut to Greater Sydney. An investigation by New South Wales Health revealed the missing link between 13 cases in Liverpool with the Moss Vale cluster. For more, I'm joined by infectious diseases expert Dr. Paul Griffin, who joins us now from Brisbane. Doctor, good morning to you. Just first of all, when we heard that news just then about that Oxford vaccination, your first thoughts? It's pretty good news, huh?
It's great. I mean, we're going to need a number of vaccines to hopefully get us through this. That's three that have generated really impressive results now, and one, of course, that we have capacity to manufacture right here in Australia. So that is exciting news.
You won't have any dramas taking it?
Absolutely not. As soon as the vaccine's approved here, I have complete faith in our regulatory process, and as soon as it's approved, I'll be putting my arm out to receive it.
Definitely. Same. Alan Joyce revealed last night on A Current Affair, it was a great interview with Tracy, you'll need a vaccine to travel overseas. Some people, they're up in arms about it right across Australia. Do they need to get with the program, do you think?
I think so. I mean, there's a precedent here. We've got a few countries where you need vaccines to travel for other viral infections. And, you know, we know that prolonged close contact indoors is high risk, and that's what you have in international travel. And so, to me, it makes perfect sense.
So let's move things back to Queensland now, and Brisbane in particular, the power base there. Anastasia Palaszczuk has some big decisions to make. Do you think that she'll keep the borders shut to New South Wales?
Look, it's hard to say. I think it really is time to open them. We have some, overly cautious targets that were set. Those targets have now been achieved. So, to me, it makes perfect sense to open those borders. I mean, we need an agile response based on facts. And, you know, we need to be able to close borders if the situation dictates it. And I think we should rightly open them just as quickly as soon as it's right.
Maybe the big decision here is, from her perspective, let's see how New South Wales go with all the Victorians coming into New South Wales now. Let's see how the cases go. Wouldn't it be prudent to have that little bit of caution?
Potentially. We've got such excellent control now. You know, Victoria will have achieved the 28 days, I believe, by Friday. It's around 31 days now in New South Wales without unlinked transmission. We know where these cases are. Our contact tracers are doing a fantastic job. So to me, it just makes border restrictions unnecessary. And, you know, we may need them again in the future. And I think the longer we persist with something that's not completely necessary, the harder it might be to reinstitute when it's required.
So Premier Gladys Berejiklian, who's on the show in just a couple of minutes' time, says the Queensland government is making stuff up as they go. But her messaging, that being Anastasia Palaszczuk, has been pretty consistent, hasn't it?
It's been consistent. I don't know that the rationale has been clearly explained. You know, 28 days is a really long time, and one that would fit very much with an eradication strategy. And, you know, from what we've seen recently in Adelaide, eradication is just not what we're aiming for. We're aiming for aggressive suppression, and that really means border restrictions perhaps should be able to be relaxed after around 14 days, not 28. So I'd really like to know the rationale here so that we can all understand why these decisions are being made.
Do you think Greater Sydney is and should be still considered a hotspot?
I don't, with the level of transmission we have there. We have a great nationwide definition of a hotspot, 0.4 cases per 100,000 people. And I would think if we applied that national definition, then New South Wales wouldn't be considered a hotspot. South Australia or Adelaide would not be as well. So, you know, we could relax all of those borders if we applied that national definition, which to me seems ideal.
So from a medical point of view, what is the sensible thing to do for Queensland?
I think it's time to open the borders. You know, I really appreciate the hard work that our state government have put into keeping us all safe. But I think when the situation allows, which it does now, it's time to reopen those borders. And obviously observe closely, and at the first sign of any trouble, consider reclosing them. But I think it's time to open.
Paul, she just got elected based on the fact that she was keeping Queenslanders safe.
Yeah, that's right. I mean, obviously, as I say, she's worked hard. She's done a fantastic job, and she's, you know, that's been very popular, and I completely understand that. I think, though, that when the situation allows and, you know, her own definitions have been met, such as in the case in New South Wales, then I think the right thing to do would be to apply that and reopen those borders.
Good on you, Paul. Lovely to talk to you today. Appreciate it.
Pleasure. Thank you.
Over to you, Ali.